Hey, what's going on YouTube? This is F. Linus Brantley again. I'm the photographer known as FLB with FLB Photography. And I've been going over a couple of these oversimplified videos because I'm, being the history geek that I am, I love going through his channels and watching his take on it. And believe me, they truly are oversimplified. What they caused me to do is like to go back through and actually, research the events that his videos covers. But this one particular here, World War II, is basically the war that defined the beginning of the events that will make up the latter half of the 20th century. World War II basically, was signified by the end of global empires. It was the end of England as an empire. It was the end of France as a minor empire. It showed the rise of capitalism and the rise of the U.S. on the global stage as a global leader. It also saw the rise of communism and the spread of communism throughout the world and the places that it did reach. It was the rise of better ways of diplomacy. So instead of going to war whenever, somebody disagreed with something, they found better diplomatic means to resolve those differences. Also, World War II was the last time that European countries actually went to war with each other, where prior to that, they was going to war with each other like every other decade, a lot of monarchies failed. Monarchies were replaced with democratic governments or communist governments. And then after the fall of the Soviet Union, those communist governments, reverted back to democratic governments. So World War II changed a lot. Like in the case of like the decolonization movements in Africa and Southeast Asia. A lot of those countries, got their independence, and the ones that didn't get their independence, that resulted in future wars. Like the Vietnam War after the French lost it. So yeah, World War II caused a lot. It solved a lot of problems, but then it created a lot more problems. Some of those problems that we still see people around the world dealing with today. So it's probably one of the most studied events in terms of American scholars in American history. And because it's just so interesting, there's so much you can break down from it. So World War II, truth be told, there is absolutely no way that Oversimplified could cover every single little thing. So as usual, what I'll do is that, I'll put things into context in certain parts of, the video, add some things, or explain some things and clarify them. So with that being said, let's go ahead and get into Oversimplified World War II, Part 1.
This video was made possible by Skillshare. Churchill was a man with many talents. He was an artist, a butterfly enthusiast, and he had an unpublished manuscript about aliens. Clearly, he was a man with an insatiable thirst for knowledge. Maybe he could have loaded up his computer and logged onto Skillshare, an online learning community with more than 19,000 classes in design, business, technology, and more. Perhaps he was considering a side career in fashion, but didn't know where to start. On Skillshare, he would find courses in fashion design and garment construction. Or if he wanted to learn app design, improve his photography, or just how to make a really good quesadilla, he would have found courses for all of these and more on Skillshare. Skillshare gives you access to high-quality classes taught by genuine experts working in their field. I work heavily with animation, and I was genuinely blown away by the number of really useful courses available to me, like this class full of tips and tricks for creating vector art, or this one for creating character walk cycles. For an annual subscription, Skillshare is under $10 a month. And if you'd like to try it out first, then I've got a deal just for Oversimplified viewers. The first 1,000 people to use this link, which can be found in the description, will get their first 2 months of Skillshare for just 99 cents. Be sure to try it out using the link in the description and learn something new today. Now, without further ado. It's 1902. A young man by the name of Benito Mussolini moves from Italy to Switzerland to avoid military service. He gets big into socialism, working for trade unions, writing for socialist newspapers, advocating a violent overthrow of European monarchies, the whole shebang. This gets him in a bit of trouble with the Swiss police, so he gets arrested, sent back to Italy, set free, returns to Switzerland, is arrested again, goes back to Italy again, completes his military service after previously avoiding it, and then after a brief stint as an elementary school teacher, he finally returns to work.
I'm just tripping out the fact that, it's amazing that he has a record now. He was arrested, charged, convicted, served some time, but yet he was still able to become a school teacher. Maybe things were different in Italy at that time. You know, maybe things are different in Italy now. I just find that interesting.
As an avid socialist, his speeches and journalistic abilities made him famous among Italian socialists. He was anti-war, so when Italy colonized Libya in 1910, he rioted and got arrested. Then World War I came along, and once again, he protested Italy's involvement. But then he thought, wait a minute, this war could bring about the social climate needed to overthrow European monarchies and bring about the socialist revolution everywhere. And suddenly he was pro-war. But his fellow socialists didn't like his new pro-war stance, so they kicked him out of the party. So then he said, you know what? I'm done with socialism. We need something new, not based on class divisions tearing us apart, but based on unity through nationality. We'll conquer the Mediterranean and reunite all Italian peoples, just like the days of the Roman Empire. I'll call it fascismo, and it will guide the Italian nation to greatness. That's all well and good, Mr. Mussolini, but what kind of haircut am I giving you? Let's go with... bold. Italy had been on the winner's side in World War I, and they hoped they were going to get a lot out of it, but in the end, they only got a little, and they felt cheated. On top of that, a bad economy and weak governments meant that the Italian people were a little unhappy. So when Mussolini came along and said that he could fix everything, his fascist movement gained a lot of support. In 1922, he went to the king and said, "Make me prime minister, or I'll make me prime minister." And the king said, "You and what army?" "This army."
"That'll do it."
"Fair enough." Then he went about establishing a dictatorship with himself at its center. Europe had its first fascist dictator. Next up, Germany. Germany had been on the loser's side, and they got absolutely wrecked by the Treaty of Versailles. They lost territory, had to demilitarize the Rhineland, had to reduce their army to just 100,000 men, couldn't have an air force, had to pay the Allies a huge amount of money that it didn't have, and a new...
If you really want to get some insight into some of the causes that really caused Germany to go over the edge, and was really the cause of the beginning of Germany starting World War II, you have to watch the Hitler Oversimplified video, or just watch the Weimar Republic prior to World War II. That'll give you all the insight and let you know that, granted, the Allied powers, what, no wonder war, you know, but they won World War I, but they're just as culpable as anybody for starting World War II.
A new rule was established that every Englishman withheld the right to walk into the center of Berlin, pick out any German they wanted, and spank the hell out of them. I made that last one up, but it helps you understand how all of this felt to Germans. On top of that, a bad economy and weak governments meant that when a small angry man with a silly mustache came along and said that he could fix everything, the German people loved it. Hitler had been a soldier during World War I, and he was crazy patriotic, and nobody was madder than him about Germany's humiliation. He helped start a new political party, and in 1923 attempted a march on Munich with his boys. And then he got arrested. But his popularity grew and grew, and in 1933, the president made him chancellor. He believed he was Germany's great destined savior, and he went full megalomaniac, establishing a dictatorship with himself at its center. Europe had fascist dictator number two. Hitler and Mussolini had a lot of the same ideas, but more importantly, they had the same enemies, and they started to get along. Anyone else want to be friends? Franco? No? You good? I do. Who's that? It's Japan, and they've taken over northern China. Let's rewind a bit. Japan had isolated itself from the rest of the world for over 200 years until the Americans showed up and said, "You're gonna trade with us and you're gonna like it." Then the Western powers imposed a bunch of unequal treaties, meaning Japan's economy was bust. They also had no natural resources, so they decided to go get some. They went to war with China to gain a sphere of influence over Korea, and they took a bunch of China's stuff. But then the West said, "Hey, cut that out." And since Japan couldn't take on the West, they said, "Okay, I guess we'll just go home." Wait a minute, what are you doing? Taking advantage of a weakened China and setting up spheres of influence. But I was the one who weakened them. We know. And you guys didn't let me have anything. We know. That seems unfair. We don't think so. Okay, see ya. So Japan thought, screw this, and went to war with Russia, and stunned everyone by actually winning. Then they fully annexed Korea, but they didn't stop there. In World War I, they took Germany's colonies and islands in Asia. And then in an incident that was maybe staged by the Japanese army, a bomb blew up a Japanese train in Manchuria, giving them an excuse to launch...
Actually, by the way, when they took over Germany's colonies in Asia, that was actually during World War I when Japan actually was fighting on the side of the Allies. So at one point in time, you know, Japan, the UK, France, United States, and anybody else that fought against the Central Powers, Japan was on our side. But it's how they got treated during the Treaty of Versailles that led to them to really make the decision, okay, you know, about this, we can't deal with the West like that. So.
launch an invasion and take over. So here's the situation. Nazi Germany, Fascist Italy, and Japan all believe they're racially superior, all feel hostility towards the Allies, and all want to militarize and take over more stuff. And so they did. Let's start with Germany. Hitler hated the Treaty of Versailles, and now he was ready to begin undoing it. In complete violation of the treaty, the first Luftwaffe squadrons were set up, conscription was introduced, and he pimped up his army. The Allies did nothing. Then Hitler sent his army back into the demilitarized Rhineland, giving orders to immediately retreat if the Allies showed up. The Allies did nothing. With his military re-strengthened, he could now move on to step two. He wanted to rapidly increase the Aryan population, and to do so, he needed Lebensraum. Or in other words, he would have to take over the world. But for now, a good portion of Europe would do, and he began eyeing up his neighbors. The Allies finally started to get worried, so they implemented a fairly useless diplomatic strategy called appeasement, and it went a little something like this. Hitler would say, "I want that thing." And the Allies would say, "You can't have that thing." "Okay, you can have that thing, but no more. I want that thing." And repeat. In 1938, Hitler's army marched into Austria and just took it, with no resistance. Boom, this is Germany now. Next, he demanded to be given the Sudetenland, an area of Czechoslovakia with many ethnic Germans. The Allies held a meeting with Hitler in Munich and said, "Look, we're gonna give you what- Hang on, this meeting is about my territory, shouldn't I come to the meeting too? Anyway, we're gonna give you what you want." "Really?" "Yeah." "Just like that?" "Yep." "What's the catch?" "Just sign this piece of paper promising you won't invade the rest of Czechoslovakia." "Okay." Then Chamberlain returned home victorious, waving his signed piece of paper in the air, declaring crisis to be averted and the continuation of world peace, and we built a statue of Chamberlain in his honor, and every day on the 30th of September we celebrate Chamberlain Day. Hitler's invading the rest of Czechoslovakia. What? He's invading the rest of Czechoslovakia. Oh. You lied to me. What do you expect? I'm Hitler.
Neville Chamberlain, was the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom. And truth be told, he gets a lot of scorn, and you know, rightfully so, really, truth be told, when you think about it, over his policy of appeasement. But again, you have to think about the context of it at the time. World War II started, well, at least for Europe, I think it was about 1936, if I'm not mistaken. Started about 1936. And World War I ended in 1917. So you're looking at less than a generation between each war. The Europe, especially Britain, they lost, I forget how many men, you know, they basically lost almost a generation of men. And now war was so destructive at that time that when they saw, you know, German aggression again, the last thing that anybody wanted to do, and that was everybody, that was France, that was the UK, that was the US, it was everybody. And as far as I know, I think it was even Russia too. But nobody wanted the war. So what Chamberlain did, he did everything that he could to try to prevent from sending millions of men to die. You know, so yeah, while it was, you know, his policy was effectively useless, you can't really help why they did it. But on the same token, that policy also allowed Hitler and Nazi Germany to really start inflicting a lot of pain on a lot of people. So yeah, in context, you can kind of understand why, but you can still see why it was effectively useless.
Not to be outdone, Mussolini also wanted to get in on the action. He thought to himself, isn't there a not yet colonized nation somewhere which is so underdeveloped that the people would be defending themselves against our tanks with literal bows and arrows and wooden spears? Oh, there is? Fantastic. And so he took it. Italy also wanted to control the entrance to the Adriatic Sea, so they occupied Albania. Then, in another incident which was maybe staged by the Japanese, gunfire was exchanged by Japanese and Chinese troops at the Marco Polo Bridge, and the Japanese launched yet another invasion against China. They swept through Beijing and Shanghai, and then advanced to the Yangtze Valley to China's then capital, Nanking. It was here that saw the worst of Japan's shocking atrocities committed against the Chinese people.
Yeah, as much as it's not taught nor talked about, yeah, Japan, you know, committed just as many atrocities, as Germany did during World War II. But we don't really talk about that too much anymore, which I find ironic because Germany and Japan are both of our allies now to this day. So we can't use that as an excuse. So why do we not really talk about Japan's atrocities? And what's even funnier is that in Japan, they don't really talk about World War II. The only thing they talk about World War II is when the U.S. and Japan was at war, and they especially harp on, you know, Hiroshima and Nagasaki, you know, but they never talk about Nanking. No, look it up. It's called The Raping Nan King, and you see how sadistic the Japanese were.
Back in Europe, Germany and Italy made their relationship status official by signing the Pact of Steel. Then, Hitler turned his eyes towards Poland and the hated Polish corridor, splitting Germany in two. At this point, the Allies really had to put their foot down, and they warned him that an invasion of Poland would mean war. Hitler had planned to continue his advance eastward, but he didn't want to end up fighting a war on two fronts, so for now he made an alliance with Stalin, saying, "How about we both invade Poland and split it between the two of us, and I definitely won't not refrain from not betraying you sometime in the future." Sounds good. This new alliance stunned the West. On the 1st of September 1939, German troops entered Poland, and Britain and France declared war on Germany. The Poles fought hard, but they were no match for the two giants crashing down on them from either side. Then came a period known as the Phony War, where everyone just sort of sat around not doing much. The French had...
Okay, I'm going to try to limit how much I pause, but it's I have to put context to some of the things that they didn't cover. When Stalin made that pact with Hitler, it was called the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, that basically allowed them to divide up Poland. But also what it did is that it allowed Stalin to go ahead and take the countries of Latvia, Lithuania, and Estonia, you know, which Estonia had already just got its independence after World War One, so there was literally a country for less than 20 years. So, but no, due to declassified documents from the Soviet Union era, it came to find out that, yeah, they was planning on backstabbing each other. You know, Stalin was going to, you know, stab, you know, Hitler in the back at some point in the war, you know, just like Hitler backstabbed him. What Stalin wanted to do, he wanted Germany, you know, to go ahead and fight the West, you know, France, the UK, the United States, and anybody else that wanted to join them, let them expand all of their military, you know, capital or whatever, whatnot. And then they'll just go ahead and sweep over the border and just take all of Europe virtually unopposed and just spread communism all over Europe. You know, it just so happened that Hitler stabbed them in the back first and, launched Operation Barbarossa into the Soviet Union. So, for lack of a better term, pardon my French, but neither one of them was shit. You know, so fuck them. You know, both of them got the end, and both of them got their just desserts in the end.
Had launched a small invasion into the Saarland, but they maintained mostly defensive positions, and after a while, decided to just turn around and call it a day. Speaking of France, the French were still super proud of their victory in World War One, and they hadn't really moved on from it. They still used horses, they dispatched messages by motorbike instead of using radio, orders from the commander-in-chief were usually pretty vague, and the troops were rarely inspected. They built a line of defenses along their German border, but didn't bother extending it all the way to the channel, and they wouldn't launch artillery strikes against Germany out of fear of being retaliated against. In a war, they didn't want to attack the enemy. And at first, the UK wasn't much better. Chamberlain still naively hoped that the war could be ended diplomatically. Instead of bombing raids, the RAF dropped propaganda leaflets over German cities, which one air marshal said likely did nothing but provide the continent with toilet paper for the duration of the war. They also only sent 200,000 men to France, while the French had mobilized millions. Both Britain and France wanted to avoid a repeat of the First World War, and so they wanted to keep the war as far from home as possible. So they turned their eyes north, towards Norway. Neutral Sweden was exporting iron ore to Germany through neutral Norway, so the Allies asked them if they could please stop exporting iron ore to Germany, but this request was refused. Then, the Soviet Union attacked Finland, so the Allies said, "How about we land troops in Norway and move them across Sweden to go help out your good pal Finland, and along the way maybe take control of all your iron fields?" But Norway and Sweden still said no. So the UK mined the waters around Norway to force any transport ships into international waters, and they also attacked a German tanker they found in the area. Hitler realized what the Allies were up to, and he quickly moved to secure his supply of iron ore. He launched an invasion through Denmark into Norway. The Allies rushed to land troops at keyports along the coast, but Germany had taken control of Norway's airfield, and their air superiority decided the fight. The Allies had to retreat. After this slightly embarrassing failure, Chamberlain resigned and was replaced with Winston Churchill, who had a slightly different approach to dealing with the Germans. Hitler's overall strategy was similar to Germany's First World War strategy. Attack France, defeat France, knocking out the UK in the process, then turn on the Soviet Union and win the war. During the Phony War, the Allies had given Hitler time to prepare his forces. Now, he was ready to attack. The Allies had wanted to place troops in Belgium, but Belgium had refused, and in a move that surprised pretty much no one, Hitler launched an invasion to get around France's defenses. The Allies charged into Belgium at full speed to meet the German invasion head-on, and it looked like a repeat of the First World War was coming. But this time, Hitler had a trick up his sleeve. blitzkrieg. As the Germans advanced, they sent thousands of refugees westward, slowing down the Allies. Then, to the south, the French had left the Ardennes, an area full of hills and forests, pretty underdefended because they thought it was naturally impenetrable. Well, the Germans were about to penetrate it with everything they had. They smashed 50 Wehrmacht divisions through and encircled the Allied armies at lightning speed. The best of the Allied forces were now trapped. The Germans squeezed in from all sides, taking out France's best armies and nearly wiping out the British too. But they managed to make a desperate last-minute escape at Dunkirk, with British civilian ships even making the perilous journey to bring their young men home. With most of the French forces depleted, the Germans breezed through, taking Paris, and France fell. What the Germans couldn't do in World War I, Hitler had done just like that. Hitler hoped that with the fall of France, the UK would also lose hope and sue for peace. But quite annoyingly, it didn't, and he needed to secure the Western Front, so he tried to force them into submission with mind games. The UK were now all alone, and Hitler wanted to emphasize that. First of all, just before France fell, Italy finally declared war on the Allies, making the UK's situation even worse. Next, instead of just occupying all of France, Hitler occupied the coastal areas for defense, but allowed France to continue its existence as a German puppet state. This way, it looked like the UK's old ally had decided to switch sides. Hitler also hoped that the UK wouldn't attack any of her old allies' navy bases or colonies in Africa, giving Hitler an extra line of defense to the south. But the UK made sure to respond to this by sailing down to France's navy base in Algeria and wrecking a bunch of ships. So have at it. Hitler then began laying down plans for an invasion of Great Britain. Before German troops could land on British soil, he would first need air and naval superiority across the Channel. Waves of German bombers came, while the completely outnumbered RAF worked bravely around the clock in an attempt to quell the German attacks. At first, the Luftwaffe targeted British ports and coastal facilities. Then it attacked RAF bases, crippling the RAF's ability to defend the nation. And it looked like Hitler's Great British invasion was coming. But then, Churchill ordered a small, pretty insignificant bombing raid over Berlin. It didn't do much damage, but Hitler was furious, and he immediately ordered the Luftwaffe to refocus its attacks on civilian targets in London. Children were sent off to the countryside, away from their parents to avoid danger, and frequent trips to air raid shelters became a daily occurrence. But British morale held firm. Smiling, knitting, lounging casually, these people have balls of steel. This refocusing on London also gave the RAF breathing space to reorganize, so Hitler kind of shot himself in the foot there. Just the foot for now. Finally, the Luftwaffe sent one massive all-out attack on London, and the RAF successfully repelled it, destroying many of the German aircraft and placing air superiority firmly in British hands. Hitler's invasion had to be postponed, but the bombing of British cities continued for some time.
Yep, so again, that was the beginning of World War II, and it almost started. I can't really say it started something like that. The shooting part started, you know, something similar to World War One, where basically, you know, Germany just went on and blitzed through Belgium. Only this time, there was never really that treaty between Belgium and the UK. Saying that, okay, well, if they attack you or attack through you or even touch you, we're going to invade. You know, again, it's like nobody wanted to fight. Nobody did. At best, they wanted to contain it. They wanted to contain it in that area to where it wouldn't go through their particular country. But Hitler was a little bit smarter about it. He did try to do something different than what they tried to do in the First World War, which, by the way, Hitler was a World War I veteran, so he knew firsthand the effects of warfare on it and learned and adapted different strategies and tactics. But he did learn that, you know, yeah, it would be smart to try to fight a war on two fronts, between, you know, in the West and in the East. The only reason that he attacked Russia was because, you know, Germany was low on resources. Germany was not the greatest oil producing region, and that is probably why he went and broke that treaty and invaded the Soviet Union. Up then again, Stalin, he was an idiot, because it was no secret that Stalin hated communists as much as he hated Jews, because he blamed both communists and Jews, you know, for the embarrassment and the humiliation of Germany. So, you know, why Stalin sat there and even attempted, you know, to enter into that agreement with him. Yeah, we know the first part, because he was going to stab Hitler in the back eventually anyway, right? But why he did it in the first place, I have no idea. Because truth be told, well, not that at that moment, Russia wasn't the military juggernaut that they turned out to be towards the end of the war. So yeah, that kind of just bought us some time. Just answer my own question. Gotta love history. But anyway, that was World War II by Oversimplified. You know, just one of his many well done videos. And I will say this, and I will keep saying this. History teachers, if anybody just happened to stumble on YouTube, convince all your history teacher friends and compatriots and associates, you know, about this channel, because you can use this as a resource to get your students engaged in history, not just to learn about history, but engaged in it and to actually enjoy it, you know, because somebody like me, like I said, I already loved history. I just hated the way it was taught. You know, now had it delivered it like this with a tool like this, oh man, I would have been, you know, proud. I probably would have had my doctorates in some field of history, you know, years ago. But that's World War II. I gotta give it again. Shout out to Oversimplified. Part two will be coming up soon, so just they check back. You know, it should be posted within the next day or so. Also, if you haven't done so yet, like this video, subscribe, leave a comment in the comment section below. Let me know what, you know, videos that you might be interested in, that you might want me to react to. I'm open to react to any and everything because I love experiencing new things. You know, so with that, I'm FLB, Flynn is Brantley with FLB Photography, and this was another reaction video. So with that, peace out. They say there is still a global pandemic out there. It's nothing to mess around with. I've known some people personally that's died from it. So let's be smart about it. All right. Peace out.